Yeah, thanks, Simon. As Simon said, my name's David. I work at Information Logistics, which is probably somewhere around. In case you're wondering, it's International Men's Brown Day. And what better excuse than to wear a... I don't have my screen yet. So, if anybody's fresh, taxes belong to Linux NASCAR, so bring some dance one into the day, hold a bit more fun. Cool. So, let's see if I can get this guy on the road. Cell phones off, please. If they're really cool, you can get them to yeah. Said, why would you change? Don't they do pretty much the same thing? My wife's an occupational therapist, and she just says what we do with them, and they do end up doing pretty much the same thing. It's why you would change. That's really interesting, and what the change feels like to us. So, at a Python user group a while ago, Simon suggested that maybe I talk about the experience of moving from .NET to Python, and how it changes the type of Python developer you become. So today's talk, I'd like to cover our story at Information Logistics, details on getting started, what the tool chain ends up looking like, it's a bit different from that, typing, kind of elephant in the room, and we're going to go back. So starting off with our story, we started off developing Zerp, and anybody familiar with Zerp? Okay, so I know, we started there. Just so on the show, anyone developed with Python in the room? Cool, just checking. Anyone developed with .NET in the room? Anyone developed with both? Cool. So, after our first idealistic project with Zerp, we helped, they say, no business plan to survive first contact with the customer. And the customers wanted .NET. Because they wanted to build and maintain it and support it, and they were so much bigger than us. So we went over to this wonderful new shiny thing called .NET Python. And it was kind of cool. That was back in 2004, and the framework was newish, and it was also batteries included, and they asked to do Windows testing. We were happy. Then off we went, we carried on for a while, and come to sort of today. And for this talk, I was doing some interviews with people to sort of understand what their feelings were like. And a guy called Peter Brick over at Alan Gray had this to say: if I had to choose a mainstream language to do a project, I'd choose Python over Java or C#. So in his mind, Python has become a mainstream language. And that was news to me, because when I started with Python, it wasn't a mainstream language. And here's a senior dev over a financial institution calling it a mainstream language. So while we've been guttering away .NET 1.1, .NET 2, .NET 3.x, running our own little websites in Django, Python had kind of come up and showed itself off. And we still couldn't really justify it to anyone, because we sell teams, and to get the whole stack up in a week, we weren't just the 7 people in mobile using Windows, it was stupid. So it took the Google App Engine to really change that around for us. Because suddenly we had a product that really allowed us to give to a startup a working, fully integrated system from day one. Rob talked to us a bit in his live and talked about the App Engine yesterday. And we can start building and deploying code on servers in much lower cost than anything. No one needs to buy anything to get started that. And actually, this quote, I'm quoting myself, but I feel I'm allowed to do it because I was referencing something else. So, it's kind of silly. And we got to build services, but the other thing was that for startups, the Google App Engine was gold, because now you're building on the Google platform, and that's like wonderful. So, we moved over to App Engine for like 90% of what we did, and then suddenly I started to do some cool stuff, so we started to look back at it a little bit. So, a couple of mandatory Python references. Another check, who's watched the Crystal Logo? Okay, good. So this talk will go a lot better. disclaimer, I didn't interview anything on it. Cool. So, we brought back a strawberry in the form of .NET 4, and we offered them a strawberry. We backed in the lands of the Knights of the Seine. Rob is kind of doing some things. That kind of covers our story of where we went, how we got back in there. So, I then, to do this talk, I thought, well, I'm not like the ideal guy because I'm Python first, so I interviewed some people and got some ideas on what it's like to get started with Python. Getting started, the first person that I chatted to was Rob. And he said when he moved over to Python from App Engine, the first thing that struck him was the simplicity. I'm sorry. Moved over to Python from .NET. And really, I think that is born of the fact that you know, we will be working in Python. I'll go to a gratuitous demo just now where we'll take a look. To the obvious next point, which everybody gets stuck on, which is coming up right now in a PowerPoint near you. The white space, right? There's a hell of a lot of it up there, and I don't know why I'm not getting the slide. There you go. So, Malta, who works with me, I interviewed him, and he was like, using white space for structure was initially scary. However, he was the guy in the .NET land who was a self-described white space Nazi. So, he didn't crack a smile and was like, yeah, but now it's just naturally pretty. So he was quite happy on the syntactical side. That's pretty obvious to all of us, so it's a great point that we lose out on a lot of fluff. And Peter, the guy who said he liked Python, I crossed the territory with him. He's really a dumb job guy, but this isn't just Python going to be very. And I talked about the places. And he started to get up, but he's also a very smart guy, so we discussed it through, and our conclusion was that because we don't use punch cards anymore, there's not much point, because most programs these days, with very few exceptions, are stored in files. So, we can preserve our white space. It's maybe an old discussion, something that has been around. I've got a great audience today, people who really know what they're talking about, but back to Rob, who said that when he started moving between them on this topic of syntax, the Python syntax started showing up in the C# code, but his C# syntax never showed up in his Python code. So it was almost that the Python syntax was more natural for him to work with the code. And that ties back to the reason that Peter over at Alan Gray first started learning Python, because he said that people actually, developers describe their problems in Python. But it's kind of just a wonderfully naturally expressive language that if you're going to write something on a whiteboard, well, Python's great for that. So those are some of the impressions on getting started with Python for people coming from .NET, just like some of the starters. To kind of illustrate what's going on there, I will show you a gratuitous demo and so I thought instead of doing some heavy coding with typing skills looking at a little screen down there, I'd instead just go through some of the tutorial screens to show you how people would get started with the two different frameworks. So if we look at App Engine, which is our Python environment, it starts with quite a long preamble. Very Python-like. actually understand what you're going to work with. And it describes that you're going to need to pick up the Python MSI because you're in Windows, because you're a graphic developer. So that's about 15 megs. And then you're going to need to pick up the Google App Engine MSI, which is about 27 megs. And then you're pretty much good to go. That's the deployment phase on the Python side. If you look over to ASP.NET MVC 4, there's this little blue box, almost like there's a forethought. Like, it's not actually important, but if you need to do this, you should go and get set up with Visual Studio 2012. There is an Express Edition available. Due to the power of the marketing machine, when you click on the link to go download the Express Edition, they give you a great thing to download the Ultimate Edition, which is rather heavy and rather expensive. But even then, you end up eventually finding Visual Studio Express 2012 for web, and when you figure out which of the buttons to click to download it, and have no idea whether you're getting 64 or 32 bit, it's 500 minutes. For the Express Edition, with everything stripped out, just for web today. So that's a bit of a slap in the head, because you really just want to try something, and they're giving it away for free, which is great, but it kind of hints at a dragon lurking deep inside. So these are some of the sadnesses looking back at the Visual Studio work. Then we look at the first example. Well, clearly Python guys are programming for, right? And clearly the App Engine team have it as well, because they started with a Hello World. Hello World, which is a simple request header. Those lines of code, you copy paste those into a text file, you create a configuration file, you copy paste those into a text file, you give it a read, get a bit of an understanding of what's going on, and then you proceed to test it by running it, and then actually you can iteratively develop that. As for that, I'd like to just show you what I'm talking about. So, in the traditional cooking show, so this one I prepared earlier, I've created helloworld.py. You'll notice the Pi C's not there because I actually just created it because I'm trying to build the demo thing where it should fail. And there's the app.yaml. Both of those are just copy pastes from the website. And Hello World.py looks like that as it looks on the website. And would anybody like to go through this a little bit? Are they familiar with that app too? We're up to app.yaml. It's more just to show you the simplicity that I wanted to pop it up. And then the launcher is a little bit of homage to the Windows guys. You can go to the command line and run append it. Command falls on my head right now because I'm a bit of a Windows guy. But you can create an application. But all this does is says, well, tell me where it is. Create any code for you there. So, it did. I've never seen it create code. What do you think? Okay. folder, they bow again to the Microsoft guys around and say, well, let's just throw these files in here because that's what you expect it to have. Useful because it is, it can display.
Something's wrong, we need an IDE. We need to stop what we do.
again. And so, like, that's awesome. You've got this whole chain of simple tools to put them together. You're like, well, how do you refactor? And then figure that out. It's not hard in Python. You know, there's no types and there's no this. And then being the great guys they were, they went and they found stuff. And the leading free thing was Eclipse. And it was horrible. It was quite sad. And we were working with Eclipse for a while, until I took a gander at Python. And I've looked at enough Python IDEs, and I was a bit jaded. But the fact that Guido had reviewed it hardly favorably, and in particular, that he said that PyTorch definitely feels like learning to drive an 18-wheeler, having only driven your favorite luxury brand sedan. So that's kind of what an IDE feels like most Python does. But the key point there is, of course, if you're used to Visual Studio, it's probably so much of a chip, not so much of a jam. And if you're used to Visual Studio, you're actually probably used to Visual Studio with resharping. And because Resharp actually makes Visual Studio work nicely. The cool thing is that the guys who make PyCharm also make Resharp JetBrains. So it turns out they also make IntelliJ IDEA, which is a pretty good idea to use. So instantly you're up and running with something very similar to your .NET stuff. And yes, that's about 100 things to download, so you know, it's pretty heavy to get like an 18-wheeler track of the Python world. It takes a while to load. But then you can do refactoring, and it does copy script support. You can do refactoring across your JavaScript, normally would. You can go to definition through writing for all that code navigation stuff that we're as well with in Visual Studio, but it's so damn hard. Yep. We tried quite a bit. We played with it a lot. It was, the difference was kind of, we were Windows guys, and people, you know, like install PyCharm, and people have gone to a lot of effort to make it easy and to just pay it. And they get paid for that, right? And we were quite willing to pay the corporate license of $200, which is not one of our favorite quotes in the office. 10,000 Rand, which is what it costs to get an ESDN for a developer for a year. And 10,000 Rand is a cry of anguish, actually, because whenever the Visual Studio or that tool chain throws up on you or doesn't do something you expect, and you're like, wait, PyCharm does that, or wait, the freaking console does that, why can't you do that? You're a big text editor. From Rob's corner of the office will come 10,000 Rand, and then he'll get up and we'll have to go play foosball, because it's up to that point. So this great tool chain tells you what you need to do, and stuff in there that if you pay more you get to use is things like TFS. Does anybody use TFS? Okay. You're a lucky bunch. No, you're a lucky that day, with the exception of you, I'm very lucky. Because it does everything that you need, but it doesn't do anything really well. But as Knight once said, you must cut down the mightiest tree in the forest with a herring. So there you are, trying to learn something with it. And if you really take the time, you can get it out and start, figure out a scene that you can stick your own tool in to use KDF or anything that you really want to use. But it's really hard to like break apart that beautifully intertwined system. I use beautifully with time too. So that's kind of what it feels like. You pay your 10,000 Rand, or you try to license Visual Studio just on its own. Don't try that. Just one with Visual Studio. It's like, don't do this all in SDM. Just give me Visual Studio, and we must have wasted weeks coding Microsoft to hold us to go to Parallel Connection to try to apply it. And if you go to Parallel Connection, and they say, no, we don't say that. Go to Resound. You go to the Resound. Oh, we've got all these awesome models that you can buy it with that reduce the price if you're a really big company. And we were like, but at that point, we just wanted one license for one developer so that we could just do this one new project in 2000X, whenever it was, in 2005, that we wanted to remove all the genre. We needed something from the console to change, but we So yes, we got stuck with a bunch of herrings. And I, while I was working on this talk, I came up with the idea of the difference between Japan and Lego. I don't know if this is a metaphor that's been used before. It's familiar. No? Cool. So did anybody play with Japan as a kid? Okay. And the other hand, anybody play with Lego? Anybody play with both? But there are differences between Meccano and Lego. One of the first differences is that every Lego brick has the brand name Lego on it. And Lego bricks only work with other Lego bricks. And you can generally build something that looks kind of like what you want out of Lego. It generally doesn't do anything useful. So, on the other hand, Meccano is just a bunch of things with holes drilled into them that you can just extend by bolting things on. In fact, you could drill holes into other stuff in your house if your parents didn't see, and you could bolt a Meccano on to that stuff and get it working. So this metaphor on the tool chain of the Python stuff versus the Microsoft stuff is interesting to me. And I was we had a movie night at my house last night, and I was explaining this metaphor to see if it worked on mom programmers to my sister-in-law. And she said, yeah, that reminds me of a curse that I once heard. It said, may you step on a piece of Lego. Because if you've never stepped on a piece of Lego, you know it really hurts. It's kind of like trying to cut down a tree with a herring, I suppose. So, yeah, a couple of other things. Lego probably understood that you could only build like a general house-shaped things, and sometimes if you bought the car kit, you could build a car that looked like that. You would never build those Meccano things that were so awesome, like the traction engine. You build it up and put bits together, and it kind of worked, and off it went and did its thing, and you could build steam engines and all this crap if you wanted to do. So if you look at Lego now, though, it's pretty different. It's kind of like looking at the evolution of the Microsoft system. Like, Lego will give you a spaceship with a Lego block on the top that you can plug on. And they say that's Lego, because the little man can stand on there, and you can buy those little men in little pockets. And now you've got a Lego ninja guy, and he can stand on top of the spaceship and be like a space ninja. On a perfect spaceship that is not extensible. So, I really enjoyed that metaphor when I came across it. I wanted to share it with you guys, because I think it really cut to the core of why I don't want to step on Lego. Can we call that Sigwin? and a lot of people didn't have Lego because it's much better marketed, and you have to buy it, and you want the car, and you want the this, and you want the that, and you want the other thing, and on it, you generally have to use it all together. So it's quite a deep metaphor that I played it for a while, and I extracted things that I enjoyed. So, where are we now? We're on what Ulvi Gulyev, the architect at Microsoft, not Microsoft, but also at Android, Frederick.net guy that I found out he's also very keen on America. So he kind of said, well, what about the elephant in the room? Python. And I wasn't talking about Python, because Python's not about being dynamic, it's about language ultimately, you know. It's about community, it's about an awesome tool chain, it's about the cool things we do. But those things maybe come from the fact that it's kind of a freedom thing. There's a space around being dynamically tough. Yeah. So typing. Typing is an elephant in the room. Typing comes up quite often. Jeff Atwood in Coding Hara has a famous article called "We Are Typists First, Programmers Second." Yes, it's my horrible type. But it's also quite horrible because we actually, if you start in a strongly typed language like C-sharp and you work in it for a while, you become a typist. People start to think that languages are built up with building blocks, with letters and types, and that's how they interact. And Ulvi is a much smarter guy than me when it comes to like analyzing languages and PhD people. I hope I don't offend him. He was saying that types aren't fundamental to programming, but it's so hard to change those building blocks in people's heads. And his insight that I loved was, because we don't have types, in type in that way, you're hyped, but because you're not strongly hyped, most of what you end up doing more algorithmic stuff rather than focusing on how all these types are going to interact, how you're going to prevent dependency, invert or inject, how you're going to create a fancy interface to do this and to do that. I'm not a philosopher, but I've heard it enough times with different people, maybe someone like Adrian Fillon from Google, whose theory is that the language you have constrains what you're going to express. And if everything you have to do starts with a strong type, you're going to think about those a lot more than the algorithm on the inside. And if you're always grappling with that, well, it does change the way that you're going to work. And also, it works for me, you were saying that they're kind of like safety nets, having type safety. And in the beginning, you're like, oh, what am I going to do? I'm not sure this is going to work. My code's not going to be as robust. But after a while, you said, it just is. It works. And he's German, so he doesn't practice well too often. But he said, not having those safety nets is freedom. It's, and then he went on about society for all. So it's really interesting because to take those safety nets away, we have to be more responsible, we have to be more respectful, and we also don't focus on the stuff that's not important. So yeah, that was really cool as an insight for me. In terms of going back to the land of the knights that saved me, we are no longer the knights that saved me. We are now the knights who say, Eki, 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 the Tanzu boy. Two has to and say me every now and then. Because sometimes project constraints, like what the customer wants or what they have, will come in. And the cool thing that we found going back and forth and back and forth is that things we learned in the one space map really well in the other space. For junior developers, media developers, and senior developers. So like a junior guy will come in with Python, learn about lists, and then go back to .NET. The collection operators that you get from our the link collection stuff, it helps you understand once you've done, when you're in .NET and then you're like, where's my list comprehension? Oh wait, there's another tool that I can use it. And then when you've been coding for a while and you've got this sort of architectural tool chain, and maybe even a .NET architect comes up to you and says, well, we need to use a looking at Rob, because he's got one, came to him and said, we need to use a Node.js for the rest. And when what comes out of his mouth is, I think we should use Mongo. But that would be cool, you know. And it does work. And then, I'm sure everybody's familiar with this, a couple of years ago, the new static type in .NET, which is dynamic. So there's now a static type in .NET called dynamic, so you can actually call main things as dynamic and do some magic to figure out what's required. It's useful for doing Excel interop and things like that. It's not so useful for many other things because the language is still fundamentally built that way, and the framework is fundamentally built that way. It's kind of, and I hope I don't offend anyone, but it's kind of almost as horrible thing as under your iPython. You keep one thing into stuff without wrapping up. I haven't done iPython for long enough to actually get rid of it, but when I tried it, it was like completely gone. So we do go back. It's fun to go back, but we're definitely no longer the knights that say me. We're the knights that will let knight two say me every now and then if people really want it. And that pretty much covers what I wanted to say to you. But that wasn't what I wanted to hear. So what was in the store? We started with our story. We went through like how someone would get started on Python from being in the .NET or some of the hurdles in the roadmap. Speedruns, typing, with some horrible puns, and then thinking about going back. And actually the value of going back and forth, and it's kind of gets into pragmatic programming space now where you're like, actually learn a new language, come back to your old language, or start in one language, find a language that suits your problems better. coders. Python programmers normally put the code up and it's like three lines. But like, look what I did. And kind of if it doesn't fit above the fold, it doesn't even survive in most Python spaces. Like, if you want to write a library, it needs to be simple enough. You can read it on a web page and then, okay, cool, I get it. I'm going to use it. And each tool is nice and simple because there's no massive marketing machine. And that is where I want to end today because it's the idea that the environment in which the language lives, like Lego versus Component, changes what is going to come up. They're both fundamentally construction tools. But because you need to be able to market it, marketers don't like taking stuff away. So that's the end of the speech. You guys get to run away to lunch. I don't know how we're doing on time because our time is before we talk again. Are we good?
Good.
We have some questions.
Yes.
Excellent. If you want anything about me, my about me is up there. Yeah. In the words of King Arthur, don't run away to lunch. Used it for more.
I really like your metaphor of Meccano and Lego.
Thank you.
And I just want to say something general. I think this is, you use now Python and .NET or Microsoft, but it's more actually open source and closed source proprietary. And also a little bit more the Unix philosophy versus maybe Windows, in the sense of open source allows you to burn your fingers or to expose everything to you that you can do what you want and build amazing things, and it doesn't shrink wrap anything. So just wanted to mention that I think it's not specific to Python. I think Python has this attribute, or this is something of Python because Python is open source. And secondly, just about the typing, just a clarification, Python is strongly typed, it's just dynamic. It's static and versus dynamic, and a weakly typed dynamic language is, for example, JavaScript. No worries. I mean, I also sometimes have to kind of refresh and figure out what is it actually now, but I remember just was.
Yeah, I completely also on the open source thing. I was wonderfully canalized by this speech that Simon suggested to me, so I guess for one dimension, but for me, it's part of the community. If you look at other, even in the open source space, tool chains that pop up or text, that's also very humble community.
I agree with that. Or the Rails community, they're the programmers.
If we could find that technical ease without Google Grant, it would be hard to say. But it took someone like Google giving us the technical ease, because we got the ideas like a continuous programming script that's written and maintained by someone else that we just couldn't find before. You know, we were writing all that stuff ourselves, even in the .NET world. So the brand was really important to us, and the technical ease was, if it was as hard,
I could just connect my laptop.